नमस्ते ऑल, ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ यंग सोल्जर्स ऑफ स्वामीजी, ए वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू ऑल। सो वील स्टार्ट द प्रोग्राम विथ शांति मंत्र बाय शुभजीत रॉय। आई रिक्वेस्ट शुभजीत टू स्टार्ट द प्रोग्राम।
ॐ श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः। हरिः ॐ सहना भवतु, सहनो भुनक्तु, सह वीर्यङ्करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। ओम शन्नो मित्र शन्वरुणः, शन्नो भवत्तर्यमा, शन्न इन्द्रो बृहस्पतिः, शन्नो विष्णुरुरुक्रमः। नमो ब्रह्मणे, नमस्ते वायो, त्वामेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्मासि, त्वामेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्म वदिष्यामि, ऋतं वदिष्यामि, सत्यं वदिष्यामि, तन्मामवतु, तद्वक्तारमवतु, अवतु माम्, अवतु वक्तारम्। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। ॐ भद्रं कर्णेभिः शृणुयाम देवाः, भद्रं पश्येमाक्षभिर्यजत्राः, स्थिरैरङ्गये स्तुष्टुभागुंसस्तनोभिः, वैसेमदेवहितैर्यदायुः, स्वस्ति न इन्द्रो वृद्धस्रवाः, स्वस्ति न पूषा विश्ववेदाः, स्वस्ति नस्त्राक्षो अरिष्टनेमिः, स्वस्ति नो बृहस्पतिर्दधातु। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। ॐ तच्छयोराभ्रीनिमहे गातुय्यज्ञाय गातुय्यज्ञपतये दैवी स्वस्तिरस्तु नः, स्वस्तिर्मानुषेभ्यः ऊर्ध्वं जिगातु भेषजं, सन्नोऽस्तु द्विपदे सञ्चतुष्पदे। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। ॐ असतो मा सद्गमय, तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय, मृत्युर्मा अमृतङ्गमय। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। ॐ पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। हरिः ॐ तत्सत्। श्रीरामकृष्णाय अर्पणमस्तु।
थैंक यू शुभजीत। वी आर वेरी ग्लैड टू प्रेजेंट द वर्कशॉप सम रिफ्लेक्शन ऑन सेल्फ इंक्वायरी बाय डॉक्टर शांतनु प्रामाणिक। सो ही हैज कंप्लीटेड हिज पीएचडी फ्रॉम इंडियन इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ साइंस in mechanical engineering Bangalore 2019. He is a active member in Vivekananda study circle of Bangalore. So due to his throat problem, so he has recorded some part of his talk and share it with us. I request to Shantanuda to start the session.
Thank you, Nikhilesh. A very warm welcome to all of you. I hope you will enjoy this talk, and I suppose we all will, after the end of the session, we all will have something to understand and something to discuss so that we all are enriched. I'm sorry I had some throat problem, so I'll maybe conduct a part of this session live, particularly the Q&A session, if there are some questions. And welcome you all. Love to all my juniors and pranams to all my elders. Nikhilesh or Sanchit, you can start the video next.
Namaste to everyone. I'm Shantanu. Namaste to everyone. I'm Shantanu. And today I'll be sharing some experience from some self-inquiry that I have been doing for some time. So I have been listening to talks, reading books by Swami Vivekananda, and listening to talks by monks of Ramakrishna order, and reading several other books. So I am also a seeker like all of you here. And the purpose of this talk, what can you expect from this talk? So I would like to share some insights and experiences of self-inquiry. And I consider this as a casual discussion because we all are seekers, so that we can all mutually benefit from it. And I am not at all an expert in this, because in fact self-inquiry is a very advanced topic, but I thought maybe we can just have a discussion, and there might be mistakes in it. So any mistake is solely due to my misunderstanding. So take it with that thing in mind, and let us get into it. So to put the entire spiritual journey into context, there is a very nice there is a book by Gyanananda Bharati called Jiva Yatra. There is a commentary, or rather a short article written by another person on this book, Jiva Yatra, so which presents our spiritual journey very nicely. So if you can see the figure here, it shows the first part of our journey, of our life journey, that is worldly pursuit. And the second part of our journey, that is the spiritual pursuit. And it says that there is an ultimate destination at the end of this spiritual journey. So what it actually means is, for all of us, we have maybe done some studies, degrees, we are working. We are always looking for some happiness, for some contentment. And we are always disappointed somehow at the end of the work, because we only get temporary contentment with all the seeking in life. But there is always an inherent urge to find some permanent rest, permanent happiness and contentment in life. And at least no other discipline claims it, but at least spirituality claims that, yeah, there is something called an ultimate destination, that is an ultimate point reaching where we do not need to travel any further. And when we reach that destination, we can live joyfully. And essentially all jivas, all of us are actually searching for that destination. And that is the goal of our life, and all our activities are actually knowingly or unknowingly directed at that. And having some experience of life, we all are in this spiritual pursuit. So we intuitively maybe feel some kind of lack, something is missing, which maybe the worldly activities will not provide us. So at least spirituality claims this. But at the end of it, we may think, okay, fine, but the world is not going to change. We still have to work, still have to do other things. So the world will remain as it is. So then what changes precisely, that we suddenly from being dissatisfied, uncontented, to becoming contented? So the change comes in a change in our knowledge, in a change in our perception, how we look at the same thing. So previously, how we looked at the world and its objects and its happiness, sorrow, suffering, how we reacted to it, how we perceived it. And after the spiritual journey, there is a change of perception. Basically, the entire journey is a reversal of perception. So while in the journey, we already have an old view of the world, and we are trying to establish or understand a newer view of the world, which is more close to our experience. So during the journey, there may be some conflict, and all our sadhana is to make this shift in perception. So the change comes in a change in our knowledge, in a change in our perception, how we look at the same thing. So previously, how we looked at the world and its objects and its happiness, sorrow, suffering, how we reacted to it, how we perceived it. And after the spiritual journey, there is a change of perception, basically. The entire journey is a reversal of perception. So while in the journey, we already have an old view of the world, and we are trying to establish or understand a newer view of the world, which is more close to our experience. So during the journey, there may be some conflict, and all our sadhana is to make this shift in perception. So to understand, okay, that what are we actually trying to change? First, we have to understand that how do we actually look at the world currently? Whatever are our current beliefs, belief system about the world that we are trying to change, that is causing suffering. We may not explicitly talk about it. We may not put it in words precisely, but these beliefs exist. And based on these beliefs only, we operate in this world. So one belief is, so some of these, so we can broadly classify it as a branch of philosophy called realism. It's a particular view of the world. What is this view? This view is that objects by itself has existence and are independent. What does it mean? It means that say I am an independent object, and the laptop in front of me is an independent object, and they both exist independent of each other. Not here independent in the sense they depend, they exist in its own right. Not that its existence is dependent on some other reality. So there are many versions of realism which may be subtly different, but for our general discussion, we can consider that we are limited individual creatures, and that is one of our belief. And then there are world objects, space, time, planets, stars around us, which also exist independently. And we live for a certain amount of time, and at the end of it, there is death, and then there is birth. People die and people are born. So this cycle continues. And another, so that is how we operate, that we are a limited being in this world. And how we perceive the world, it is that there is an object, independently existing object outside the world. We have sense organs. These sense organs, so this outside objects actually create some kind of produce some kind of, reflect some kind of light, sound, etc., which is captured by our sense organs, and they produce sensations in our body, and those sensations are taken through the nerves to the brain, and the brain interprets it and produces a picture of that object. So there is an independently existing object outside, and that object is then interpreted, or a image or a perception of that is created in our brain, and then somehow the brain perceives it. We don't know how it is perceived, but somehow the brain perceives it, and we are conscious beings, we are aware, brain produces that awareness. So to actually validate realism, since objects are existent and independent, and they are made of matter, matter is existent and independently present. And so brain actually produces consciousness, and that is how we perceive the world. So then there are two things. There is an object which is present, and then there is a perception of the object. So that is how we operate in the world. What Vedanta proposes is something different. Vedanta says that the perception, the shift in perception that we are talking about, Vedanta says that existence is not independent from consciousness. That objects exist, but not that they are independently existent. There is a overarching global reality called consciousness, and in that reality, objects exist. And it's not that there is an object and then there is a perception of the object in the brain and brain produces consciousness, but the object and the perception are the same thing. That we can never separate an object and its perception because we have never seen an object in our brain. We have seen some nerves producing some electrical signals, some molecules, etc. But then we don't know how do they produce consciousness, or we have never seen any particular object residing as an image in the brain. So Vedanta says the object and perception of the object are the same thing. They are not two different things. And so it is kind of 180 degree opposite of realism. And it says that reality is consciousness. And a good way to understand is the dream example. For example, we all have had dreams. So in dream, we may see ourselves in the dream. We have a first person experience in the dream. But the person in the dream has a mind, has a body, is looking at the sky. But all of that is happening inside the dreamer's mind. So dreamer's mind is something similar to awareness. And the body and the mind that the dreamer has, or that the dreamer kind of projects within the dream world, that is the kind of experience we are having. So all of this experience is actually within awareness. So it is kind of a parallel example to that. So if that is the goal, that is the kind of change in perception which Vedanta talks about, so where does self-inquiry fit? So to change from realism, in which we are a limited being with a body and mind and the brain producing consciousness, we have to actually inquire into things. That is this perception correct? Because some of it is conditioning, some of it is our survival instinct, some of it is we are born with. So to change it, in the spiritual pursuit, one of the tools is called self-inquiry. We actually try to look deep into it and try to come to conclusion that whether what we are saying or what the conclusions that we are drawing, is it correct or not. It is also called the path of knowledge in spiritual pursuit. It is characterized by Shravana, Manana, and Nididhyasana. So Shravana is basically hearing. We all have been doing hearing lot of talks by various Swamijis on YouTube and other discourses. Manana is actually cogitating about it, contemplating on it, trying to clear doubts. And Nididhyasana is a type of meditation called Vedantic meditation, where we try to crystallize that knowledge. It is also a very direct path, because the goal is a shift in perception. The goal is knowledge, a correct understanding from a wrong understanding of reality. So if knowledge is the goal, then the path of knowledge is the most direct. And this reality, which Vedanta Upanishads presents to us, is called by various names. One name given is Brahman. It's also called as Atman. In English, it is translated as consciousness or awareness, also called as Chetana. Some provisional words which we can use to get a good feel of it. To begin with, we all know we are aware, but the first thing is we have to understand what this awareness is. If we don't understand, then it always like gets stuck. Okay, fine, Vedanta is talking about awareness, but I still feel like a limited being. Yeah, I have these problems. It does not solve our problem actually, because until and unless it solves our problems and removes our suffering, it is actually of not much help or good. So one particular provisional definition or word is knowing. We all have a sense of what knowing might mean. There is an object and just the knowing of that object. So knowing is actually awareness. So we can hold to this word knowing to kind of go deeper to understand, okay, what might awareness mean, and then we'll see, okay, if it makes some sense. For some, it some words like presence or clarity or love, they actually represent some meaning. So they are intuitively able to grasp, okay, what awareness is by these words. And Vedanta from beginning to end talks only about awareness, 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 consciousness and Brahman, and only that. And it is only interested in that. Other minimal definitions of consciousness or awareness might be that to which objects appear. So it is also knowing, if you can understand, that entity to which objects or all objects appear. So it is sometimes also called the witness, or also the seer, one who sees. Dridrishya Viveka is called Drashta. In Gita chapter 13, I think, in Krishna calls it Kshetrajna. And the tool in this self-inquiry is direct perception. Direct perception means looking at things as they are, as blankly, as openly, as bluntly as possible. And as close, trying to be as close to our experience as possible. So that is one of the ways, that is the way it is proceeded. So what happens is our daily, everyday experience of any object, any hearing, any sensing, any sound, any emotions, any thought, any touch, any sight, all of this can actually become tools to understand what awareness is. We can do a small exercise. We'll try to hear a sound. So it's not a logical exercise. We'll try to, it's not like in thought, like, okay, this is the sound, and then we'll try to conclude something. We'll try to intuitively feel what awareness or knowing might be. So it might take around 2 minutes. So just wherever you are sitting, be relaxed. I'll play some bell sounds and just listen to it. And then we'll try to understand what its implications might be. Just that simple experience of hearing a sound. Just be relaxed and sit comfortably straight. Just be open and aware. If there are some other sensations or feelings around, other noise around, let them be. Just be aware of your body. Just scan your body from the head, gently, gradually downwards. Up to your legs. To see that you are comfortable. Just be aware of your surroundings. Be aware of anything that arises, any sound, any sensation, etc. Within that, I'll play some sounds next. Don't search for the sound. Just let them come to you. Can gently open your eyes. Okay. So this is a very common experience of hearing a sound. So if you were aware, you heard a bell sound going off like 5, 6, 7 times within the last 1 minute. So let us try to look at that experience of hearing a sound and try to understand, okay, what happened. So there are two things that happen. There is a sound which is existent. There is the sound exists. But simultaneously, one more thing happens. You know that the sound exists. Try to recollect that experience or hear the sound again. So not only does the sound exist independently, there is a knowing of the sound also, and they are simultaneous. So the existence part of it is called Sat, and the knowing part of it is called Chit. So if you calmly contemplate on this, you will understand that not only does the sound exist independently, it does not exist independently. Simultaneous to it, there is a hearing or the knowing of the sound. So this experience is quite opposite of realism, which says that the sound exists independent of awareness, of knowing. Second point, the existence of the sound is known. It points to the unseen seer. What does it mean? You know the sound exists. The sound exists and you know the sound exists. Now, which part of you knows the sound exists? You can try to locate which part of it exists, which part of it knows it. You will see, okay, it's not my legs or my body. As we also discussed, brain, although it may feel like, yeah, maybe the brain is, but that is again a belief of realism. Brain is again matter, dead in not matter. It's like saying there is a box in front of my hand, in my hand, and this box is hearing the sound. The box is not, the brain is not hearing the sound. But that the sound is being heard is known. You know the sound is being heard because you are hearing it. But what is hearing that sound is not known. That is the seer, that is the witness, that is the unseen seer. You try to go within and try to maybe, within quotes, look back. Who is trying to see it? will never find anybody seeing it. But that there is a knowing entity is clear because you are having this first person experience. This knowing entity is what Vedanta is pointing to. That this knowing entity is the unseen seer, is the witness awareness. And if you also go a little ahead, so there were some gaps between the sounds. So if you look at your experience, you heard the sound began, it ended. For some time there was a gap, there was no sound. And again the sound began, again it ended. So in between two sounds, there was a gap, no sound. But you were aware that there was no sound. So it was not that awareness was not present. You were aware that there is an absence of sound. And again, you were aware when there is a presence of sound. And this continues. And awareness, if you see, is constant through the entire process. It does not change. It is the sound that is coming and going. The sound begins, it ends. But awareness is constant throughout the entire process. Now, if you take this as a sample of how objects are known, then you will see awareness actually exists prior to the rising of the object. Because you were aware when the object was not present, you are aware when the object is present, and again you are aware when the object is not present. So whatever we have ever known, so sound is just one of the examples. Whatever we have ever known, be it sight, be it touch, be it sensations, thoughts, all of them are known. All of them fall in the category of objects. All of them are seen. The body is seen, the body is felt, the body is sensed. The universe is seen, space is seen, time is felt. So all fall in the category of objects. But awareness, if you see, is constant through the entire process. And if you see that actually this knowing entity, this awareness is actually you who knows the thoughts present in the mind, the sensations arising in the body, the good mood, the pleasure, the pain, the suffering, etc. So awareness, that is knowing, is unchanging. Objects of awareness keep changing. So that is the distinction, the separation Vedanta wants to make. That all that we see, feel, hear, sense, are drishya, are objects of perception. But awareness, the knowing entity, the witness of it, never changes. So using this small example, we can actually go deeper and deeper and contemplate and try to understand what awareness is. How are they related to objects? How is awareness separate from objects?
Hello, Sanjit.
The video is complete.
Yeah, Santanuda can.
Yeah, there was one more exercise that we can conduct.
Using this small example.
It's okay, Sanjay. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah, here some participation will be necessary. Here we will, it's called finding yourself. So I'll ask the question, and some of you can maybe give an answer or maybe write it in the comments section. Then we can proceed from there. So our usual way of feeling is that we are somewhere inside, encased in this body. So we are embodied beings. Somehow we are located somewhere in the body. Now, if we try to analyze where are we exactly located, so let's try to do that. Where are we exactly located? What is the predominant feeling? So suppose we imaginary, we create a plane from our stomach downwards and upwards. So if somewhere to ask, someone were to ask whether we are located below that or above that, what would be the answer? Where do we feel in general? Where do we feel we are located, upwards or towards the legs?
In the heart.
Yeah, in the heart. Yeah.
Okay. Then let's directly come to the answer. Where else do you feel we are located?
In the brain a little bit and in the heart.
Okay, heart, brain. Okay.
But sometimes you feel it in the stomach also. Because that's why they call it gut instinct and gut.
Okay, fine. That is also a good answer. Any other answers?
Throughout the body.
Throughout the body. Good.
Sometimes in the breathe in and breathe out.
Breathing in and breathing out. Okay, good. So, okay, let us take this as a sample of answers. Somebody said it's the heart. Somebody said stomach.
In brain.
Pardon?
In some brain. Brain. Okay. Brain.
Behind the eyes, inside the head, between the two ears, something like that.
Brain has control all over the body, and some is there in brain or somewhere in the brain.
Okay. So we got several locations. Now, if something is true, we should be able to find it. So in this exercise, whatever the answers were, say in the brain, in the heart, in the stomach.
Good morning, sir. I wanted
yeah.
to tell that, is it mind, sir, who tells us what are the things we are suffering from and what are the things? Yes. Mind.
Okay. We'll take that question at the end maybe. But do you have a predominant feeling like where you are existent, embodied within the body?
Existence means heart only, sir.
Heart. Okay.
Yeah. The other person said the heart only.
Okay, fine.
It is middle of the Hridaya Kamala Madhya, sir. Where we in spiritual language we tell that lotus of our heart, lotus of means middle of our heart.
Yeah, I feel it in the head mostly because even while I am meditating, so like I feel the locus of attention is at the head. So like even like I am keeping focus on the breath, I feel like the breath is at the lungs. Like I am at the head. So from the locus of attention is from the head. Like I can feel the sense of space. Like I'm at the head and like I can feel the distance from head to lungs. Yeah, mostly I feel it at the head.
Okay, great.
Yeah. Pranam, sir.
Yeah, Pranam.
I think on the basis of situation, we feel upward or downward, but not exactly the genuine point or what the actual we are, we can't reach that point. And it should be our motto. Not downward or neither the downward or not the upwards, the actual what the actual we are, and just to neutrally analyze that.
Yeah, we'll analyze that and see whether we are present in the body or not. But if you are to say like, okay, 50, 60, 70% of the time, I feel I am somewhere here or maybe near my heart, where would that location be? So that is the question. It's a not an exact question, but it's a feeling, intuitive feeling, like, okay, here I am.
Okay, then I will go with heart.
Heart, okay, nice. Okay, let us take these answers. So whoever said that wherever the location be, as the predominant location where they feel themselves to be. Let us investigate whether we are there or not. So we can gently close our eyes and be comfortable and try to bring our attention to that particular location, be it the heart or the brain or any other part of the body where we feel predominantly to be embodied. Not just thinking about it, directly looking at it with our attention. Bring our attention there, not thinking that maybe I am there. That is a thought. Just bring your attention to that location. And stay like that for the next 10 seconds and try to find yourself. Observe and see, what do you see? As objectively as possible, what do you see? Observe for the next 10 to 15 seconds. Okay, so I suppose all of you have observed it. Can I get some answers, like what did you see? It can be anything, like I saw myself sitting there, or there was nothing, blankness, darkness, anything, any answers?
It was a slight grayish kind of space inside, and the predominant feeling was the sensation of breathing, breathe coming in and breathe going out. It was predominantly that.
Okay, good. Any other answers? Anybody, what was the feeling when you looked at that location? There are no correct answers here. Whatever you observed, just be direct observation. Whatever you observed, it can be nothing also.
Even the sense of I is also an object of awareness. I can feel that I am, like a person is there in head. So that also is an like object in awareness.
Okay, so let me ask. So when you looked at your head, say inside your head, near your brain, using your attention, what do you actually see directly? What do you see?
I feel that there is a person inside, like a...
Did you see any person?
Yeah, I do not see a person, but I can feel, like, there is some kind of feeling that there is someone, like, there is a locus of attention, so which is placing attention on something, so that okay. I can feel.
Okay, so you placed your attention on something. What you placed your attention on, what was there? You did not see a person. So did you see anything?
Nothing in particular. Yeah.
Nothing in particular. It was fine. Yeah. Okay, great. Any other answers?
Sir, it feel like a... loneliness. When I concentrate in brain, that not feel I'm there, but somewhere I am stay, but it not explained.
Okay, so you did not find yourself there, but you feel like you are there. You feel that. Okay. So we can get a variety of answers, like some colors we can see, some sensations we can get. Somebody I think unmuted. Okay, there was rest. Okay.
It feels like nothing is permanent. Everything is empty. Whatever we want to catch up, but there is nothing. This kind of feeling.
Okay. Okay. If I ask you a very straight question, like what do you see? Just like if you are opening your eyes and you are seeing something, maybe you are looking at your mobile phone or computer now. If you are looking inside your head, what do you actually see?
Primarily, it was blank, but blank. After some time, it's some point because I was concentrating on that point or some to such a point. So that's why a light or power, this kind of thing.
Okay, so we in general got some answers like, okay, blankness. There was in particular nothing. There was a feeling that there was something. Maybe green color, sensation of breath, etc. So all these are objects, cloudy images. Okay, so we see cloudy images there, but we directly do not find ourselves there or anything that may say that, okay, that particular thing we are seeing is ourselves. What I would like you to contemplate and reflect is that the one seeing that location is the real you. The attention, the person knowing that location, understanding, seeing that there was a green color, there were cloudy images, there was a feeling, there was nothing, there was blankness. That one in the background, that is the you. That is the witness awareness Vedanta is talking. So try to do this exercise, feel it, and see if it makes some sense. So these are kind of some short exercises that can be conducted to actually, along with hearing and contemplating and understanding, these are kind of experiential, perceptual experiments that help to crystallize the ideas. Okay, there is one more small portion of the video that was recorded. I request Sanchit if he can play that.
So we have talked about Sat and Chit, that is existence and knowing of existence. They are both simultaneous. But why is it also called Ananda? Ananda because all our perceptions of suffering, pleasure, good, bad, all dualities arise in this knowing awareness. And this knowing awareness is actually, if you calmly sit, you'll see that in principle, you'll understand it is not really affected by whatever arises in it. Just like the sound, it arises, but awareness stays constant. Before it, it precedes the sound, while it is constant, while the sound exists, and it is constant, it is again constant, unaffected after the sound dies down. Many people use different other words to express this kind of feeling. They feel free, open, spacious. If somebody says, be like the, we have an intuitive understanding. If somebody says, like, be open and free, and be like the sky, be like space. So we have an intuitive understanding what it means. So awareness is sometimes these words are used to describe awareness. Spacious, unconditional love. Why unconditional love? All dualities arise in it. It never resists or stops anything. Everything arises and naturally dies down in it. And it is that way completely neutral, completely unconditional. And that's why some people even call it love, the highest form of love possible. It is also of the nature of space, light, like it illuminates all our experience and all our experience and all existence itself. And it is unaffected by objects. And existence, knowledge, bliss, or Satchit Ananda is basically the essential fabric of it. It's very nature. It's not like when we understand this, then there is a happiness, pleasure in the mind. But awareness by its nature is existence. By its nature is of the nature of knowing or knowledge. And by its very nature is of bliss or Ananda. Not that it will be in happiness or Ananda sometime later after I understand it. That refers only to body mind. And as awareness, we are always perfect at this very moment. That's what the shloka om purnamada purnamidam. It is always complete, always full, always contented. And Vedanta tells us that we have to realize that, realize this truth. It's already present. We have to realize, understand, and accept and own it that, okay, this is how things are, as compared to how we have been actually thinking about our world, about our limited existence. So that is the shift in perception which has to take place. And another difference that takes place is what is called a conceptual versus a non-conceptual mind. Conceptual mind is when we are trying to think in terms of concepts. Like there is a concept called sweetness, and there is a particular experience of eating sugar. Now, sweetness is a concept. The eating of sugar and tasting it is non-conceptual experiencing. So Vedanta, so direct experience or self-inquiry tries to use this, that experiencing something and building a concept around it are completely two different things. And it says us to, tells us that all books, everything are basically concepts pointing to awareness. All experiences are pointing to awareness, but they are not, they are objects in awareness. So gradually when we understand it, mind gradually becomes free of concepts and tries to become open, free, spacious, devoid of concepts. So lot of our ideas, suffering, good, bad, everything, dualities arise in our concepts. So gradually we become free of those, the mind becomes free of those concepts, and that gives a great relief, contentment. That is what the teachers and the books say. Summarize and to share some experiences, as I understand till now, in this path of self-inquiry, the first step is to recognize what this awareness is. And in the next step, to understand what is the nature of awareness. Is it limited by the body mind? Is it one awareness per person? That is the Sankhyan position. Or is the awareness, does awareness extend beyond body mind? Is it global? How to understand the world, entire world, and this entire understanding of the world being in awareness. Is it really true? Why is it true? Is awareness really free? What is it really infinite? So these are kind of questions that we keep asking. We'll keep asking, and we have to get clarity on those answers. And after we get those answers, the next step is to understand that, okay, the objects that arise in awareness are nothing other than awareness, just like the ocean and wave example given in Vedanta. So that is when true non-duality is reached, that the objects that arise are also awareness itself. So the three steps, Shravana, Manana, and Nididhyasana, so reading, intellectual understanding. So but what I found is this small perceptual experiments and meditations actually drives home the point. It kind of experientially gives a feeling or at least some understanding that, okay, maybe this is what Vedanta is talking about. And then we gradually progress in that path. And another experience I would like to share is that we hear from many teachers and until the ultimate destination or complete knowledge is reached, there will be many intermediate steps, in the sense all teachers have a slightly different formulation of teaching. So some will bring the concept of reflected consciousness, some will bring the concept of witness, somebody may bring some other concept, but those concepts again gradually are removed. So it is better to stick to one teacher or one book from beginning to end in the self-inquiry process. So at least so that their particular formulation will work. Otherwise, too many things may confuse. In case we are not being able to understand, then other teachers, we have excellent talks available on YouTube and online resources. And we are anyways associated with Ramakrishna Mission and Ashram. So whichever teacher we follow, we may follow their formulation completely till the end. And then in the meantime, use others as resources, just like we prepare for any other thing. And one more experience I feel is like there is no believing or hand waving or glossing over. Like if I'm not understanding something, if I say, okay, maybe this is how it is. But what happens is that doubt lingers because our idea of ourselves as an individual is so strong. So when any negative experience comes about, we go about reacting the same way. So unless all those doubts are cleared up to a very deep level, it won't really help. So we have to really go one by one with all the doubts and clear them. And some reality checks, like, are we understanding it correctly? The teacher is anyways guiding us, or some book is guiding us. But are we understanding it correctly, or are we just building another concept out of it? Like, teacher may point out, I am awareness, but then I may. Happens several times. So, but then another experience comes and we feel, okay, no, this is lost. I did not understand it. So one way to understand is it is okay. Test it is okay. Is it holding up against, constant? Is it changing? Is it holding up against negative experiences, etc.? And what few things that really helps is a very strong desire to be free. That it is, everybody will have to take a personal journey because all our initial conditions are different. So we don't come from the same place. So we all have different ways of understanding, different preconditions, preconceived notions. So those have to be gradually removed. So it's, we have to basically take matters in our hand and make it our own personal journey. Because what Vedanta points out is, it is our very own, just we have to own up to it. So these are some of the experiences that I would like to share that I'm currently going through, and I'm still seeking and trying to understand these in much more depth. So these are some of the references that I have been using, that I have used to make this PPT, and that I'm currently following as well.
Antanuja?
Yeah.
Okay. So, should we start the question answer session?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so those who have questions, please raise their hand. We'll call you, your names, and you can unmute and ask your question. So you can ask your question by English, Hindi, or Bengali. So whatever you like, you can ask. So there is one question, Arun. You can ask question.
Yeah, hi Santanu. So it was a great talk. Thank you. So my question is a little philosophical. So I don't know whether it's a platform to ask this question. So like ever since I started started reading about Advaita Vedanta, so like it reminds me of subjective idealism in the Western philosophy. So how these two philosophies compare? And second question is, so when we say that everything exists in consciousness, so does that mean that suppose if I put it like this, suppose if there is a distant star which no one has discovered yet, which no one has discovered yet, so does that star still exist? like because we know that so before we existed, before any life form existed, there was Earth and galaxies. So there was no evidence of consciousness at that time. So my question is like how do we interpret this like the from the point of view of consciousness as the fundamental reality? So you know like this is the question of you know, realism and idealism. And the final question is my interest in Advaita Vedanta and Mahayana Buddhism.
I may forget the questions actually.
Okay, sorry. Yeah.
Yeah, you can ask after that. Huh? I mean, okay, sure. Let me try to answer, not that. See, I'm philosophy, subjective idealism, if it is also called solipsism, then I know what you're talking about. Otherwise, I don't know what subject, you have to explain a little, subjective idealism. Okay, but let me go to a second question. Second question, there was one part in the video which got missed. So when we say, okay, I'm hearing the sound is in awareness. Then the automatic question comes, okay, I am aware of it. What about other sounds that I am not hearing? There may be many other sounds that I am not hearing. Do they exist or not? So that was one of the points in the slide, the presentation. So what, with some contemplation, we understand that this awareness is not really attached to the body-mind. When I say I understand, it's a personal feeling that I am okay, a person, this is my field of view, this is my field of hearing, and these are the things, okay, limits of what I know. But then there are many things beyond that, maybe the other person knows, maybe there are many stars undiscovered. Currently, I am not seeing the Taj Mahal, maybe due to lockdown, nobody is looking at the Taj Mahal. Does the Taj Mahal exist? So what we gradually understand that this awareness is not a personal awareness, it's impersonal awareness. In fact, it's our way of thinking that being like, okay, I am here in the mind, or I am the mind, it's the ego identity. But the awareness is actually global and impersonal, in which the body and mind also arises. So at this moment, the body mind, one is sensing the body mind. The entity that is sensing the body mind is actually different and not exactly located within or behind the body mind. It is actually global awareness in which the entire world, let's say, exists. And so from, if you ask from which location is it being perceived, it may feel like, okay, from near my eyes it is being perceived, or maybe from my ears I'm hearing. So this is this particular location. But if you actually try to understand awareness, you'll see that there is no such particular location of perception from which it is being seen. Only we can say it is in awareness, it is the whole of it. So try to think about it. There is a slight jump, I would say, like from understanding this personal awareness to the global awareness in which the entire thing arises. So that kind of that will make more sense, that it's not me that is knowing the object, the body mind that is knowing the object. It is the awareness which is knowing the object, and awareness is not an object. It's not attached to the body mind, it's not personal. So that would be my answer. And regarding your first question, if subjective idealism is solipsism, then again, this answers the question. Solipsism kind of says that, okay, I am the only one existent. But that would be, even in idealism, that would be like stretching too far. Even many idealists, as I've heard, many philosophers would, very few philosophers among idealists will accept that there is only me existing and everybody else exists in my awareness. This is one view, but this my awareness is not really a personal my awareness. When teachers say I am aware, I am this awareness, that I am is awareness never says I am. Awareness is the experience itself. The awareness, the I am actually arises as a thought, as a sound in awareness. So it does not claim to be an individual. So we are actually drawing some experience of being an individual into awareness and thinking that, okay, but I am limited. Actually, it is not limited.
Okay, I see. Yeah, thank you. So it cleared a few misconceptions. Yeah, thank you. So can I ask this last question? So this is regarding my interest in Advaita Vedanta and Madhyamika Buddhism. So like they too talk about emptiness. So they use the word awareness and consciousness. So like if you are familiar with that philosophy, especially Mahayana Tibetan Buddhism, so how do these two philosophies compare? So I want to know this thing.
See, I have to admit that I do not know much about Mahayana Buddhism, but I have read some books. One of the teachers that I follow currently for this small meditation practices, he is a Tibetan Buddhist monk. So what I have heard is they have their Vedanta and their way of teaching has several parallels. Now, philosophically, if you nitpick and go very deep inside, one may understand, okay, there are subtle differences. But globally, they are kind of saying the same thing. And I would suggest what I personally do is stick to the theory of Advaita and try to do some of the Vedantic meditations. And for my current condition, I find some of the meditations taught by those Tibetan that Tibetan teacher to be a little more easy for me. So I try to follow that, hear some of that also, but don't really go deep into that concept, because ultimately you need one set of concepts to get out of concepts. Another set of concepts may not be necessary. So emptiness may be something similar to what Brahman is in, or awareness is in Vedanta, maybe the parallel. So whatever you like, stick to one, and maybe then once you understand it, then I think both will start making sense. But yeah, the direct answer is I honestly do not know much about Madhyamika Buddhism.
Yeah. So yeah, understood. So the point, yeah. Thank you very much. So it was helpful.
Okay. Thank you.
Arindam.
Hello. I have a question.
Yeah.
Being a reflected consciousness or ego, how to know the consciousness is possible?
Okay. So if I understand your question correctly, being the reflected consciousness, how to understand the consciousness?
Yes.
Okay, what makes you think we are the reflected consciousness?
That is ego.
Okay, ego, if you look at it, suppose you look at your train of thoughts. You look at your train of thoughts, you see that some activity is going on, some bad mood or something is going on. Then suddenly a thought arises, I am sad. That I thought, where it means that I am sad, that part is the ego in thought. But if you see, awareness is actually aware of that thought as well. So you are actually the awareness knowing that thought or looking at that thought. You're not the I thought. If you actually see it carefully, you will see that I thought keeps popping up every now and then. And we instinctively, due to our conditioning, we claim that, okay, I am sad, I'm having a good day, I'm having fun, bad day, mere saath aisa kyun hua. But these are only thoughts that come up in the mind. We are not exactly, so we are at this very moment awareness only. You just have to make that distinction that, okay, that is a thought and I'm owning up that thought to be myself. And so one way to do that is observe it, try to observe it and try to make this distinction between the witness and the object of witness and see that, then I think gradually some separation takes place and you can understand that you are always awareness. Yeah, that would be my answer.
Okay.
Could I ask one question, sir?
Yeah.
Actually, I wanted to know what is Pratyahara?
Pratyahara is one of the limbs, I think fifth or fourth limb of Patanjali Yoga. So that is a particular kind of discipline. So you try to draw in. Okay, here also I have to say this is a second hand answer, means as much as I have heard, we are trying to draw in our attention. Just like you can put your attention on certain things, you can draw away your attention from certain things and bring it to certain object. So usually we are kind of looking at outside objects, checking our mobile phones. So Pratyahara would be, in general parlance, would be to bring our attention from being scattered around from outside objects and bringing it back to, say, a particular object that we are trying to meditate on. Maybe a lotus in our heart, maybe the image of our Ishta Devata. So that drawing of away of the senses or attention from the outside objects into some particular, from the outside world within, into within, that I understand is Pratyahara.
Okay, is there any other question? Okay, if not, then we are basically the end of the program. So we are very grateful to Santanuda for taking out his time. I thank him on behalf of Young Soldiers of Samiji group. So we'll end the session with the Shanti Mantra and Jaikar by Sanchit.
धन्यवाद पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः हरिः ॐ सत् श्रीराम कृष्णार्पणमस्तु गुरु जी की जय जय श्री महामाई की जय जय श्री स्वामी जी महाराज जी की जय
थैंक यू ऑल
Nikhilesh? Nikhilesh?